Hello and welcome to the Transvalor International Simulation Days. My name is Nicolas Poulain and I'm a Director of Sales and Technology at Transvalor Americas. Today I'm going to present a numerical simulation of full carburizing process of an automotive gear. Okay, so today we're going to talk about carburizing and how sim heat handle simulation of such a process. This presentation was made with my colleague Patrice Lann, expert engineering at Transvalor SA. Here is the table of content. Going to go through the full process basically, and then discuss the results. First, let's introduce this concept or process. So this is typical carburizing process. Starts with a heating or austenization, and then we hold the temperature and then scale down a little bit where the carbon diffusion happened. Then after this carbon diffusion stage, we are going to the quenching where we have phase transformation, and we basically define the final properties of the part. You can see the part here we are going to look into, and that's just an automotive gear. So first, let's talk about the spatial discretization. So this particular process is a little bit unique in the sense that everything happens in really small thickness underneath the surface of the part. So for that, in terms of simulations, we need to make sure we have enough elements, so we have a fine mesh within this thickness. And the best way to do it with managing the computation time at the same time is to use an anisotropic mesh. Now, the good news here is for these processes, we don't need to remesh like we do for all the large deformation processes. So it makes it a little bit easier because we don't have to remesh, even though we do have an anisotropic remesher in our solutions. So what we do here is we use the anisotropy to again reduce the amount of elements. So we stretch a little bit the elements in these, in the perpendicular to the surface direction. And then we have the regular isotropic mesh for the rest of the part. So again, everything happens from the surface inward, and we need to capture that. That's what we do with this anisotropic meshing. Let's talk a little bit about the multi-physics coupled model. The word important here is coupled. What we do is we basically, it's not just different layers of calculation. We couple the thermal calculation with a mechanical computation as well as the metallurgical calculation. So that's important because a small move in temperature, for example, will have an impact on the mechanical behavior. Same thing with the metallurgical behavior. So this is coupled, which means that at each step we are calculating this impact and making sure to recalculate and solve all the equations considering all of that. Okay, so that until we reach this equilibrium. Now, for the diffusion of carbon or any other element, as a matter of fact, we have this algorithm within the or model within the entire coupled model, and again we have interaction between all those calculations so that everything is coupled, and we take into consideration any additional small change into consideration. Here are some typical thermal physical data. We use GMAT Pro for those. Those information can be hard to find. There's thermal calc that could be useful as well for the thermal physical data. Unfortunately, thermal calc cannot provide information about the mechanical, so stresses, behavior of the material. So that's what is lacking and what we need for our simulations. Okay, so here we have some information about, temperature dependence of, density, heat capacity, thermal conductivity, and so on. This is the traditional heat equation we use. not much here. I just want to show the full model. There's no shortcut in our products. And this is the elastic behavior still from GMAT Pro. Okay, so they are all temperature dependent, which is really important, even more so for this type of process, carburizing, which means also quenching and austenization. What is interesting with GMAT Pro as well is we have access to bunch of data at different temperature and different strain rate, but on top of that, here we have it for each phase, obviously for steel alloy. So that's interesting because we have we can see what compete in terms of shrinkage in some areas if we have a different phase than the neighborhood elements. So we have all this knowledge from the data from GMAT Pro. Here's the same at 700 Celsius and here at 900 Celsius. This is the full model used with addition of the phases transformation with plastic and elastic deformation as well. Okay, so first step is the heating or austenization. So the model is created so that the temperature, the critical temperature A1 and A3 are changing depending on the heating rate. So the graph you see here is the dependency of those two critical temperatures for each material based on the heating rate. So basically what you can see here is the faster you heat and the higher those values will be until a certain limit, but it's the trend. Okay, so we take that into consideration within our model. So that's important, obviously. Here are the results of the austenization. So temperature start from room temperature, goes up to above the austenization temperature. This below is the austenite ratio, which ends up at 1, meaning 100% austenite after the heating. Here we're looking at the residual stresses of unmissed stress during the same process, the heating process. And the first principle stress, which is really important to understand any potential cracks, which won't happen with the austenization, but will be important within the quenching operation. All right, so now we have heated up our part, we are going to diffuse the carbon, which is the carburizing operation. Again, the model that is used, diffusion equation, and then we see on the graph the diffusivity based on the carbon ratio. Okay, and what is important is we have that for each element. Okay, so each element in the model is subject to move based on the carbon ratio, and we'll see in the quenching that we are shifting the diagrams for the TTT diagram or CCT diagrams based on this carbon ratio. So that's the results of the carburizing. You can see it's a thin layer underneath the surface where we have the carbon diffused. The core will, you know, remain at the initial carbon ratio. So last operation is the quenching. Like I said, model is based on the TTT diagram for the phase transformation of the ferrite, perlite, and bainite. The models we use, so for incubation, is the traditional shell model. Growth is through the GMAC model, and then we use this fictive time method in order to absorb those thermal shocks. Not going into detail on that, it's really mathematical and simulation related, but we need that to have accurate results in terms of mostly the thermal shocks. The graph again explains what's happening. We have incubation, then growth of the phases. For the martensite, we use a different model, which is the Koestin and Marburger law. So here you have the law that will pilot or drive the formation of martensite. Again, really important to consider the TTT diagram at each element, which will be different based on the carbon ratio. All right, so here's an example of a TTT diagram for this alloy with a nominal carbon ratio of 0.29. It's basically what is going to be used at the core of the pot. Okay, and then here we can see how it shifted for a higher carbon ratio of 0.7, which will be used within this surface or right underneath the surface of the part, where we are anywhere between 0.29 and 0.7 of carbon, okay, due to the carburizing and carbon diffusion. Here is the models we use for, you know, taking into consideration radiation and the conduction. It's just a quick definition of the thermal boundary. And here is also something important, is to have an accurate quenching simulation. We need to know our quenching or coolant, okay? And for that, what we did, we worked with our quenching providers. In this particular case is a Quaker Houghton, a well-known US-based company. So work with them, developed all those quenching that they have, and we have all the data available for all our users directly into our simulation software here, SimHit. So you can basically just grab the file and you have a very accurate definition of your quenching that can be used, which will bring you to a very accurate results in your simulation. Now the results, we have temperature, then the austenite ratio on the top right, then bainite ratio on the bottom left, and then martensite ratio on the bottom right. So again, temperature, we go from, carburizing temperature down to room temperature. Then we have the austenite ratio that goes from 1 to 0. There's no more austenite at the end of the process. Bainite, you can see that we have most bainite inside the core of the pot, which we want because we want some ductility within the pot to absorb shocks. And then we have the martensite, which is the hardest phase on the surface. Again, that's what we are looking for, you know, to have some hardness, higher hardness on the surface. Okay. And then again, the temperature. Now we're looking at the von Mises stress, which are the residual stresses. Okay, so we want to make sure we are not cracking the pot within, during the quenching. That is also the first principle of stress, as I said, is we are looking at tensile conditions to make sure that we do not open a crack, and basically if you are in tensile condition within the high stresses conditions, you have potential to crack. Okay, so we want to avoid that and look at those results to assess this. Finally, the vicious hardness, which is what commonly used in use properties, and you have the distribution of this hardness within the pot after the whole process of carburizing and quenching. In conclusion, we have demonstrated that stimulation is very accurate, and the accuracy really depends on the material behavior model. So here at GMAT Pro, we've been testing and validating those data for quite some time now, working with the company that makes the software. We have an accurate carbon diffusion model. Phases transformation kinetics, very, very important. Again, insist, you need to have a model that will shift those TTT diagram based on the carbon ratio. So it will be for each element, we'll look at this carbon ratio and shift the transformation kinetics based on that. And you need all the models to be coupled, because if you just do by layers and one layer that will be the phase transform and some amount of bainite and martensite, for example, that is not coupled with the entire rheology, but then it doesn't really matter because you won't see the proper residual stresses, etc. So that's really important to have that. So accurate data are a must. That's the reason why we work also with Quaker Houghton to get the actual values or data for the quenching or the coolant. So work with experts to make sure we have those data. And then for the future, we are working on additional models. We already have some for hardness. We are working on additional models for all the final properties, additional heat treatment. We've been working a lot on annealing and nitriding as well, and some additional materials. A lot of work been done for aluminum alloys, then nickel base. We already have some data on air and titanium. So it's obviously an ongoing project, but we have really strong basis to now just develop and add some more models to it to reach out the entire spectrum of potential customers. Thank you very much for your attention, for staying with me during this presentation. Again, I'm Nicolas Poulain from Transvalor Americas. You can check out our website at www.transvalorusa.com. And if you have any questions, please feel free to email me. Thank you very much and enjoy the rest of the event.